and privilege, a real pleasure, a very special pleasure, to introduce today's speaker, a guest speaker from Norway, University of Agder in Kristiansand, Norway, Professor Stephen Doherty. Professor Doherty was educated in the US and then received his PhD from the University of Indiana and worked in the US for a few years before coming over to Norway as a Fulbright scholar and then stayed on and has been living in Norway for the last decade or so. He's got a number of his interests to do with literature, migrant literature or migrant literatures, and I can see some of the students who took his classes today on migrant literatures. Then his other interest is SF, science fiction. And we discovered on one occasion that we share some of the same interests. My interest in SF is very amateurish. Stephen's interest is very professional, but we share the same admiration for the writings of Stanislaw Lem, for example, and many other writers. Now, Professor Doherty won't be talking about Lem today. He'll be talking about two other SF writers. One is the Chinese writer Yu Cixin, if I pronounce his name correctly. Something, I'm sorry, Chinese speakers, probably mispronouncing the name. Who's mainly known for his trilogy, and the other name, found an easier introduction. Those of you who are vaguely familiar with SF will recognize Arthur C. Clarke as one of the icons of SF writing of the 20th century. He's the one responsible, or he's the one behind Space Odyssey 2001, together with Stanley Kubrick. They developed the idea together, and the book came from Arthur C. Clarke. But of course, Space Odyssey is not the only thing that he can be credited with, both in fiction and non-fiction. So, I give the floor to Professor Stephen Doherty.
Thank you very much, Adam. It's a pleasure to be here. Talking about science fiction, I don't know how many of you are science fiction fans, but I'll be talking about a Chinese writer named Yu Cixin, terrific science fiction writer, very, very popular these days, not only in China, but in the United States and in the UK as well, in the Anglo world. And I'm going to be talking about the relationships between science fiction writers. I'm going to be talking about the nature of science fiction, and the task of a Chinese science fiction writer in the world today. It's, in some ways, it's a strange thing being a Chinese science fiction writer. Well, let's get started then. Science fiction is a literary practice which, historically speaking, has flourished under conditions of rapid modernization. One might assume then, given the record-shattering pace of its urban industrial, technological, and economic transformations, that China would be called one of the new epicenters of science fiction writing. Yet the position of science fiction in China remains tenuous. How could it be otherwise? Through most of the 20th century, the domestic situation was marked by both public apathy and periods of political repression when indigenous Chinese science fiction production was banned outright. The relative thinness of science fiction history in China means that contemporary Chinese science fiction writers have had to look elsewhere for inspiration. As the translation studies scholar King Zhang claims, even when the genre became more popular toward the end of the 20th century, it was apparent that native writers often drew their inspiration from foreign works. Without both the widespread institutionalization of translation practices and the availability of translated science fiction, Zhang argues, Chinese science fiction would not exist in its current state, having finally carved out a niche in the cultural landscape, but still, quote, not fully mature, having yet to establish its own strong traditions. Nevertheless, the career of Liu Zixin might suggest that Chinese science fiction is maturing pretty quickly these days. Liu is a hard science fiction writer, which means that there's a lot of science in his science fiction. He's trained as an engineer, as a computer engineer. He's won the China Galaxy Science Fiction Award 9 times, which is pretty amazing. His three-body trilogy, which was written between 2007 and 2010, has met with unprecedented success upon translation in Britain and the US. Very, very unusual, I mean, in 2007, very unusual, 2010, very unusual for a Chinese science fiction writer to get translated at all into English. And the first volume of this trilogy, The Three Body Problems, is translated by a Chinese-American writer named Ken Liu, won the 2015 Hugo Award, which is a big science fiction prize, marking the first time a major science fiction award in the Anglo-speaking world has gone to a novel in translation. So this is a big step, a big milestone in the history of science fiction. For this essay, I'll explore three related concerns. Liu's negotiation with the foreign works that have most inspired him, his ambivalent response to the Chinese modernization, enabling the rise of Chinese science fiction, and his vexed attitude towards science fiction itself, towards the science fiction enterprise itself. He's, as I mentioned, trained as a computer engineer, and he's a science fiction writer, so he's part of the world of literature, so to speak. But very interestingly, he professes to have a distaste for literature. So he doesn't really enjoy literature, which is a strange thing for a science fiction writer to say. Nevertheless, this is what he said in interviews. Although the three-body trilogy is Liu's most popular achievement, I'm going to be discussing lesser-known writings around which the above concerns have taken shape in this essay, in this discussion. These lesser-known writings include a eulogy for Arthur C. Clarke, the British science fiction writer, an essay on science fiction writing, and short stories from a collection called The Wandering Earth. Now, The Wandering Earth was published, was translated into English, I think, in the year 2013. So it's been around for a little while now. In this remarkable collection, published in English translation in 2013, radiant images of advanced technology are fused together with earthy, muted images of rural and urban poverty and environmental degradation and catastrophe. Liu identifies himself as a big fan of Golden Age science fiction. So this is the science fiction back in the 1930s and the 1940s. Arthur C. Clarke is certainly a part of this Golden Age science fiction tradition, an Anglo-American tradition, and Clarke published well after that period as well. I'd argue that Liu is no more original, no more distinctively local a writer than when he's channeling the ghosts of Arthur C. Clarke, of his Anglo-American forebears, especially Arthur C. Clarke and Isaac Asimov. But Liu has had much more to say about his relationship to Clarke, and it's around this relation that this discussion orbits. My initial aim is to consider the relation between Liu and Clarke in terms of the dynamic that the translation theorist Emily Apter refers to as repositioning. Now, this is part of Liu's eulogy to Arthur C. Clarke, who died in 2008. And he writes this: 27 years ago, he was the one who gave me the idea to write science fiction. 2001, A Space Odyssey, taught me how science fiction could be used to exhibit the breadth and mystery of the universe. Rendezvous with Rama let me see how science fiction could be like a creator, fashioning an imaginary world real enough to practically reach out and touch. Later, all of my own novels are but clumsy imitations of these two classics. Liu here acknowledges his profound sense of debt to Clarke. He explains that he would never have written science fiction without Clarke's example in the first place. He could not have created his science fiction without the sense of debt, which in his act of eulogization he likens to base imitation. Liu's words express a sense of reverence and a great humility to in the face of Clark's imposing international legacy. Clark was one of the giants of science fiction in the 20th century. And Adam mentioned 2001: A Space Odyssey, and some of you are probably familiar with the Stanley Kubrick movie from 1968. And Clark helped write the screenplay for that. And then there was a novel, 2001: A Space Odyssey, based on the screenplay. And the screenplay came first, and then the novel second. And the movie came first. I mean, chronologically, the movie came first, and then the novel was published a couple of months afterward, because the movie had to take precedence. For audiences, I mean, and for people's pocketbooks. Other great science fiction novels of Clark's include Rendezvous with Rama, The Childhood's End, The City and the Stars. So if any of you are interested in getting into science fiction, Arthur C. Clarke is a really good place to start. That's where I started when I was a kid. Now, however, on the surface, these words that were up here just a moment ago from the blog eulogy don't provide much help in informing a critical practice that would illuminate the creative and productive terms of the relation between a 20th century British science fiction icon and a 21st century Chinese icon and self-professed disciple whose respective literary styles are strikingly similar and different at the same time. So this is not to say that imitation is entirely the wrong word. What I'm interested in is the relationship. Part of what this discussion is all about is the relationship between two science fiction writers, between two writers. Genre doesn't really have so much to do with it, although I have to qualify that because it is science fiction that we're talking about, and so the relation is conditioned by the fact that these are two genre writers. But I'm really interested in the nature of this sort of relationship and how it is that a writer communicates with the people who have gone before him or her, and how he or she negotiates that relationship. So this is part of what I'm interested in here too. Beyond narcissism, that I'll have this a bit to say about. Because it's a very interesting essay, and I think a really, really important essay in terms of understanding not only Lu Xisheng's attitude towards the science fiction enterprise, but also in terms of understanding his relationship to Clark. So he writes, I just read his 2001 A Space Odyssey, 1968. Before reading that book, I had on countless occasions imagined a type of literature that would reveal the vastness and profundity of the universe to me. And here, Lu Xisheng is a kid, he's a teenager, and he's discovering this British science fiction novel in translation, in Chinese. In the barren lands of the realism of that time, fiction like that seemed so far from the literature I knew growing up in China in the 1960s and 70s. So far from the literature I knew that I was unable to fathom that it could possibly exist. When I first opened that book, however, I discovered that what I had dreamed of had already been written, which is a very strange and curious thing for a writer to say. Here, then, Lu gestures towards the concept of imitation, of that which one already dreams. Imitation in this sense is akin to a self-confirmation. It's an act of self-awareness from the outside and finding oneself in relation to foreign messages, quote-unquote foreign messages, this is a phrase that he uses in the essay, that lodge themselves deep inside the psyche. The second and later remark on Clark, and I'm thinking of the blog eulogy remark first, and then this one we're looking at now, the second remark on Clark quoted above encourages us to go back and rethink what Lu might have meant by imitation in his blog eulogy, because he says in the blog eulogy that he imitates Clark. Well, what does he mean by that? Because if he's a writer, then you can't simply imitate. In order to be a writer, you have to do something besides that. In light of Beyond Narcissism, what Lu calls imitation in his eulogy seems much more like a kind of translation. In imitating Clark, Lu discovers himself authorized to translate his own incipient dreams into publicly consumable fictions. The love of Clark, likewise, turns out to be a self-love, a, quote, shocking and moving recognition of Lu's deep-seated creative urges. I think I'm going the right way there. the kind of intercultural and intersubjective exchange that Lou powerfully describes in his Beyond Narcissism essay has little to do with Harold Bloom's anxiety of influence. Lou does not willfully misread Clark, although, as I'll argue, there are aspects of Clark's writing that that Lou will turn to ironic ends. His admiration for Clark, in other words, is neither blind nor uncritical. He loves this writer, and so he uses this writer in all sorts of ways. And sometimes irony is part of the game. The nature of the influence in question calls to mind the paradigm for influence in translation that the cultural theorist Emily Apter explores in her book, The Translation Zone. This is a wonderful book, a collection of essays from 2006. Below, that means I'm going to have to flip the slide here again. Apter explains the difference of the notion of the translation zone. This is a phrase inspired by a 1912 poem by Guillaume Apollinaire. She explains what this might mean for our understanding of literary influence, especially as conceived within the compass of comparative literary studies.
Here it is.
Well,
Emily Apter's translation zone.
Cast is an act of love and is an act of disruption. Translation becomes a means of repositioning the subject in the world and in history, a means of rendering self-knowledge foreign to itself, a way of denaturalizing citizens, taking them out of the comfort zone of national space, daily ritual, and pre-given domestic arrangements. Lou finds himself jolted out of his comfort zone by Clark. Although he intimates that he did not really find much comfort there in what he describes as the barren lands of Chinese publishing culture during a notable period, this is roughly from 1978 to 1989, of anti-science fiction sentiment and official Communist Party suppression of indigenous science fiction production. Between those years, you weren't allowed to write science fiction in China. Lou is reoriented in the world and in history through his encouragement and through his engagement with Clark, whose fictions became available to Chinese mainland readers after 1978 because he, along with some other science fiction writers, was deemed safe enough for reform-era Chinese audiences by the Communist Party under the new leader Deng Xiaoping, who became the new leader, I think, in 1978 after Mao died. Lou must have responded positively to what Edward James refers to as Clark's international voice and vision. He thus finds himself as a young reader, remember he's a teenager, with a bent for speculative fiction, subjected to an opening up, a reorientation, a repositioning. Now I find this word very productive, and this is part of the title of this discussion, that word repositioning. I find the word really, really productive in terms of thinking about Lou's concerns and preoccupations years later in the short stories that make up The Wandering Earth, which, as the title hints, treats in myriad and evocative ways themes of departure, deviation, digression, crisis, drift, belonging, and exile, and which thus makes the collection essential for my purposes in this essay. I want to offer in this essay, a reading of Lou that draws attention to what I shall call, following Apter's cue, a thematic of global repositioning. Primarily, I want to suggest, through the use of this term, the manner in which Lou's science fiction, born of his own highly cathected, simultaneously disorienting and self-affirming experiences in reading Clark, registers on another level as a sensitive representation and recalibration of China's position in the world via the translated / imitated and ironized style of Clark that becomes a hallmark of Lou's fiction. Lu Xixing's writing will remind, this is a quotation, Lu Xixing's writing will remind science fiction fans of the genre's golden age with its positive focus on scientific development, explains feature writer Damien Walter in a Guardian op-ed essay on the rising profile of science fiction around the world. Yet we should also take seriously the declaration in the afterword to The Wandering Earth that Lu, quote, has endeavored to create a distinctly Chinese style of science fiction. Thinking these two seemingly contrary aims together is crucial for our understanding of Lu's relation to Clark and of his creative achievement, broadly speaking. Now, regarding that relation, the relation between Lou and Clark, I've already decisively set it up as a relation of influence. But we have to understand that this is a tricky thing to do. You know, so I'm interested in establishing influence. Well, how do you do that? You know, how do you go about making the case that one writer deeply influences another writer? Now, of course, we have Liu Zixin's telling us that he has deeply influenced me, Arthur C. Clarke. But nevertheless, in terms of textual analysis, how do you do this? If anybody knows, let me know. Because it's not an easy thing to do. And certainly the most difficult part of putting this essay together, because this is an essay that I've been working on for a while, was this part of the essay. I was trying to figure out how to look at these texts, in other words, Clark's texts over here and Liu Zixin's texts over here, and to make a case, you know, as a critical writer on my own terms, make a case for this influence and for the importance and the significance of this relationship. So this part's coming up here. I must affirm, quoting Ihab Asam, that, quote, a measure of speculation and uncertainty seems ineradicable. Okay, so if you're going to do this, a measure of speculation is just totally unavoidable. In other words, this is speculative writing. I am speculating. There's no way around it. Whatever claims I make about Clark's influence on Lou in the following section of this essay are staked against the backdrop of a, quote, and this is where Ihab Asam is quoting Lionel Trilling, a huge unrecorded hum of implication which rises from a culture or a period and insinuates itself into every literary relationship. Against that hum or white noise that is a part of literary history, wherein literary influence in a generalized sense is unspecifiable, I can begin only by imagining that Irv scene of reading on a fateful winter night in 1980. All I can do is imagine this young Liu Zixin reading Clark the first time. What was going through his head when he was reading Clark? Immediately following these brief reconstructed reading scenes, my speculative endeavor will shift to a few selected scenes of writing, and I will consider Liu's words, mediated, of course, by the work of the translator, in light of Clark's influence. So, let's get started here. This is what I'm interested in, as I said. I'm interested in speculating about imagining Lou laying in bed, late at night, reading Arthur C. Clarke, okay? So we're gonna start with an uneventful passage from 2001, A Space Odyssey. Sometimes, during the lonely hours on the control deck, this is Arthur C. Clarke then, Bulman would listen to this radiation. This is the radiostatic of the planet Jupiter. He would turn up the gain until the room filled with a crackling, hissing roar. Out of his background, at regular intervals, emerged brief whistles and peeps like the cries of demented birds. It was an eerie sound, for it had nothing to do with man. It was as lonely and as meaningless as the murmur of waves on a beach or the distant crash of thunder on the horizon. That's from page 109 of my very old and ragged copy, paperback copy of 2001 A Space Odyssey that I've had since I was 13 years old. The scene is melancholic. During lonely hours, an astronaut adjusts his radio to fill the control deck with the sound that entrances him. It's the crackling electric sound of a distant planet, which has no meaning for him except insofar as it evokes a bird sound. The simile connecting the bird cry and the planetary static elicits the comforting familiarity of Earth, yet at the same time it makes the Earth alien. The bird cry is demented, likewise the sound of waves on the beach and the distant thunder are meaningless, in spite of their romantic and nostalgic potentiality. The effect of the passage is to diminish man and decenter the Earth, to turn it into an object of deep longing, even as it is uncannily revalued in light of the astronaut's life-changing space travel. And this astronaut is on his way to Jupiter. So he's I think, orbiting Jupiter right now. So he's a long way from Earth. The aim of the passage, as in so much of Clark's most memorable prose, is to stir in the reader's soul a feeling for the immensity of the universe and for our Earthbound participation in a cosmic sublimity. The evocation of that sublimity extends spatially and serially in 2001 from the image of Earth, which the moonbound Dr. Haywood Floyd encounters as, quote, a blazing beacon hanging above the northern horizon and covering the moon with, quote, a cold blue-green phosphorescence. To the moon and its corona, quote, a faint pearly cone of light slanting up the eastern sky. To the interplanetary space traversed by the ill-fated spaceship Discovery. In other words, what we're getting here with these quotations, these brief quotations, snippets of quotation that I just ran off, we get different pictures of the Earth from different locations in space, further and further away. All the while, the astronaut's experiences are repeatedly correlated with recollections of Earth, as in this example, quote, as they grow deeper and deeper into the Jovian night, the glow beneath them grew steadily brighter. Once Bowman had flown over northern Canada during the height of an auroral display, the snow-covered landscape had been as bleak and brilliant as this. So the Earth is close in memorialization and memory, and profoundly distant too. The distance achieved spurs the question of humankind's relation to Earth. And this is an important part of my discussion here, and I don't want to go on at great length with this part of the essay, this part of the discussion. But the point is that these astronauts and this science fiction, there's an interesting thing going on. This is part of the nature of science fiction, of course, is that it's all about leaving the Earth. 2001: A Space Odyssey. This is about a trip to the outer planets and everything that happens, and about the trip, the acid trip after that. So it's about leaving the Earth. And again, this is part of the science fiction enterprise. The question of the relationship between man and Earth. This is part of what science fiction is all about. But nevertheless, for some writers, it's much more important than it is for other writers. And what I'm trying to argue is that this is tremendously important. This question of relationship between man and Earth, for Clark and for Lou as well. So ambivalence about man's relation to Earth registers in a brief scene, and I want to suggest that it's a very ambivalent relationship. It's a relationship that both Clark and Lou, in their different ways, because they're writers from different parts of the world at different times in modern history, so they deal with this relationship in different ways. Nevertheless, for both of them, the nature of this relationship is marked by a real sense of ambivalence. Ambivalence about man's relation to Earth registers in a brief scene from Death's End. Now, this was a great title novel. This is the third novel in this trilogy that we've been talking about, that I was talking about earlier. This trilogy of Lou's, a very famous trilogy, very popular trilogy right now, that's out in bookstores. So this is the third book of the three-body trilogy, where a young aerospace student reminds a compatriot of the real reason they're learning to build rockets, to leave the Earth. These two young engineers, and there's this big mission to build rockets because they need to get people away from Earth because something terrible is going to be happening to Earth. And this one young student says that, so we're doing this so that we may make life here better, not abandon the planet. Nevertheless, of course, they're abandoning the planet for the sake of making the planet better. The leaving and the staying go together, as in The Wandering Earth, which is another short story I'll be talking about a bit later on, where the migration to another star involves propelling planet Earth towards it rather than leaving Earth behind. In other words, what happens in the short story The Wandering Earth, which is also the title of the collection, is that Earth is propelled away from out of Earth's orbit and propelled towards another star. Because the sun is dying, and so they figure the best thing to do is to leave, but to bring Earth with them. And so this is what the story is all about. Is itself repositioned or reframed through modern science fiction practices as a temporary home for humans. And this nearly always elicits both strong and mixed feelings for Clark and Lou. In this persistent theme, hope and sadness go hand in hand. Now, I want to say a little bit about the kinds of stories. One of the points that I want make very just sort of in passing is that for Arthur C. Clarke, Arthur C. Clarke was a profound sort of metaphysical writer. He was a hard science fiction writer, and again, what this means, you know, the difference between hard science fiction and soft science fiction has to do with the kind of science that insinuates itself into the storytelling. You know, if the writer puts a lot of science, knows a lot about science or engineering, and puts a lot of that into science fiction, then this author is likely to be known as a hard science fiction writer. Now, both Lew and Clarke are hard science fiction writers in this regard. As I mentioned, Lew was a computer engineer, he's still a computer engineer, as a matter of fact, and Clarke was a radio engineer. He was trained as a radio engineer during World War II. So they were both well-versed in, you know, sort of science, the basic science, and it was an important part of the literary game for both of them. But nevertheless, but there's a difference insofar as there's a lot of religion, there's a lot of metaphysicality, a lot of Gnosticism in Clarke's fiction. And, you know, if you've seen 2001: A Space Odyssey, if you've seen the movie, you recognize this, and this idea that there's somebody out there, there's somebody out there that's beckoning man. There's a monolith that's discovered in the moon, and this is left over from some alien civilization that was there millions and millions of years ago, and now man has dug up this monolith, and this has sent a signal to these aliens, and now these aliens are getting ready to greet mankind, and also to sort of usher mankind into this new higher plane of evolution. And that's the style of Clarke. And so one of the differences between Lew and Clarke is that Lew does not go there. He doesn't get into the realm of the metaphysical. So his fictions are tremendously, very, very, very Darwinian, very materialist. And this is an important difference, I think. A little bit about these fictions, though. Just a real quick tour. Aliens, alien visitations. Now, there are alien visitations in Clarke, and there are alien visitations in Lew, but they're quite different. As I said, there's a sort of metaphysical quality to the alien visitations in Clarke in 2001, or in Childhood's End, or in some of his famous short stories. They're out there often to help mankind. And often, and Clarke is deeply inspired by the story of human evolution, the theory of human evolution, as Lew is. But nevertheless, they're out there, often these aliens, for the sake of spurring on the evolutionary process for mankind. It's very different in Lew's fiction, and I want to give you just a little bit of taste of this. Alien visitations, stories about alien visitors. Well, this is the stock and trade of science fiction. So it's not a surprising thing we see it in Lew, as we saw it in Clarke. Now, there's a story called Devourer by Lew. It's loosely inspired by battle scenes in Clarke's 1955 novel Earthlight. Earth is invaded by a giant ring-shaped spaceship that surrounds the planet in order to violently extract all of its natural resources. Here, so often in The Wandering Earth, the plot invokes the threat of environmental and ecological devastation. An archaeologist charged by the United Nations to plead humanity's case presents the giant alien invader, whose name is Fangs, who is visiting the site of a recent excavation with a giant photo album filled with beautiful pictures revealing, quote, all aspects of human culture. The archaeologist, this is a quotation, the archaeologist vividly described the glorious history of Earth's civilizations through all his passion into his desperate attempt to make this alien understand that there was so much on this blue planet, so worth cherishing. But this creature, Fangs, is not interested in this at all, because he's there to destroy the planet. He's there to extract all the resources that he possibly can, and then to move on to some other place. But he castigates this archaeologist for simply focusing on humankind, human culture. The archaeologist goes on and on and on about man and human culture and how much it's worth cherishing. And Fang says, well, what about the ants? What about them? Why do you care about them? Now, what happens at the end of the story is that there's a huge battle between the alien invaders and mankind. The Earth forces are destroyed. They lose the big battle, and the earth is destroyed. The only thing left are the ants. This is all that's left in the end. I just want to read you just a brief passage then from the end of this short story, Devourer, to give you a sense of the flavor of the story, because it sounds very, very violent, which it is, and there's no doubt that loose fiction is, can get pretty violent, pretty graphic. But at the same time, there's another kind of flavor about the writing too. Here's the end of the short story. Just as the thin atmosphere began to deprive him of his consciousness, the marshal, this is the general of Earth's armies, the marshal felt the tiny movements of an ant on his temple, filling him with a deep sense of contentment. As the ant climbed up to his forehead, he was transported back to his so very distant childhood. He was at the beach, lying in a small hammock that hung between two palm trees. Looking up to the splendid sea of stars above, he felt his mother's hand gently stroke his forehead. Darkness fell. The remnant ocean lay flat as a mirror, pristinely reflecting the Milky Way above. It was the most tranquil night in the planet's history. And that's the end of the story. Very, very, this passage, this particular passage, very much inspired by the style of Clark, and very sort of reminiscent, and I'm going to footnote here. You look to this story, you know, this particular story, and it sounds just like it, and tremendously, tremendously evocative of this other short story. So there's Devourer. Real quickly, just a couple more stories. There's a story called Taking Care of Gods. Now, gods. Sometimes the aliens in Clark are gods. And here's a story called Taking Care of Gods. So you think, okay, we're going to run into the Clark-style gods in a loose story. But he's having a bit of a joke on Clark, so to speak. He's being quite ironic, in other words. In The Wandering Earth, Blue writes about aliens like gods, too, yet his gods are not god-like. In a salvational sense. In Taking Care of Gods, the aliens are 2 billion old people who need food and care. So there's a giant ship that brings 2 billion very, very old people with white hair and long robes. And these ironic gods once seeded life on Earth from their great spaceships, and now they've come back in their dotage. All of them, this is a quotation, all of them looked alike. They were ancient, had long white hair and beards, and wore long white robes. But they want mainly is to be fed. At first, the old aliens in Taking Care of Gods are treated with kindness and respect, not for very long, because their needs are met with increasing resentment, because no one wants to take care of 2 billion old people. Many of the gods find themselves out on the streets. Grandchildren turn against the sons and daughters of the gods in anger and outrage over their cruel treatment. And in the end, the gods leave. These are the grandfather gods and the grandmother gods. They leave because for the sake of peace, because they're causing all of this dispute and conflict between the parents and the children. So this is an ironic twist on the alien god visitation. One more story. The Wages of Humanity. More aliens. The visiting aliens are the godlike elders who are preparing to conquer the Earth. Now, these aliens come from another distant Earth, another Earth. It's called Earth as well. Identified as the first Earth, where they were made destitute by a dramatically increasing inequality of condition brought on by the spread of what is essentially described as neoliberal capitalism. So, in other words, they got squeezed out. They became so poor and destitute, and they got kicked out in the end by the very, very few people who had amassed a lot of wealth. Inequality finally reaches a point where actually one man, who's known as the last entrepreneur, controls everything, all the resources of this first Earth. Finally, the poor are evicted by this last entrepreneur, dispossessed of their homes, their fields, their very planet, forced on a 30,000-year-long wandering journey through the depths of space. Now, what kind of fictions are these? Despite appearances, they're not contemporary moral fables. it would be very easy perhaps to read them as moral fables. They're not imbued with an unerring sense of moral conviction, even if they do address topics which might easily elicit a sense of righteousness. In other words, Lu's writing about he's writing about poverty and destitution in China. He's writing about problems having to do with a very, very quickly aging population in China. He's writing about the spread of neoliberal capitalism in China, under communist rule, but nevertheless it's capitalist society. Fangs berates the humans for ignoring the lives of the ants, but neither humans nor ants are worthy of being saved from his butchery. The doddering gods and taking care of gods are both pitiable and contemptible. The actions of the elders and the humans and wages of humanity are equally unjustifiable. Above all, Lu's short stories are complex and multivariate fictions, fully engaged with social, political, and historical circumstances. When it comes to Clark's influence, what Lu values most is the latent potential he sees there for sublime science fiction, a cosmic science fiction, to become an effective tool for thinking about the past, present, and future of China and the world. Lu rescues Clark's vintage sense of wonder from his transcendentalism or his technomysticism, in the words of science fiction author and critic Gary Gibson, and bends it to the task of reflecting on where China has been and where it's going. What his wandering fictions seem to authorize is an unstable mix. Just two more stories that I want to spend a little time with. An unstable mix of environmental exploitation and degradation on one hand, and reverence for the earth on the other hand. This instability is the product of his dual allegiances to narcissism and anthropomorphism, and to posthumanism on the other hand. So the thing about Lu is that he's a very self-conflicted writer in a lot of ways. There's a section on this essay that I've been telling you about, the Beyond Narcissism essay, that I'm going to have to skip here for the sake of time. But in this essay, Lu establishes these dual allegiances between science on one hand, because remember, he's an engineer, he's a hard science fiction writer, and between science and literature. If you're a science fiction writer, like Lu, then you're going to have, I think any such writer is going to have to figure out the nature of the relationship between the science on the one hand and the literary enterprise on the other hand. And it's not that they can be pulled apart. Nevertheless, Lu tries to do this in this essay. He thinks about the science, and he thinks about the value of science, and sort of the objectivity, as he sees it, of science, for the sake of achieving a post-human perspective. For the sake of resituating ourselves and seeing ourselves in less selfish ways. So he's got this task and this object on one hand in his sights. On the other hand, he recognizes that he's reading literature, he's writing literature, and he knows that he has to appeal to a narcissistic reader. That if he's going to be a popular science fiction writer, the only way to play the game is by appealing to the narcissism of the reader. And this is precisely, I read this, the end of Devourer, and this is precisely what he's doing. He's appealing through the use of pathos to the narcissism of the reader. So he's trying to do both of these things at the same time. Now, this is we're talking about his negotiation of the job of science fiction writing. How does he see himself doing this? And this has consequences, too, for the nature of the science fiction writing that he produces. And this is what I'm going to get to at the end here, in conclusion. Two more stories from the collection. The title story is The Wandering Earth. Our planet is prepared for migration to another star upon the discovery that the sun is burning out. Over the course of centuries, the planet's rotation is brought to a full stop by means of horrific and sublime machinery called Earth engines, so that Earth can be rocketed towards a new sun, Proxima Centauri. Earth will not be abandoned by its peoples, since it is determined that, quote, only an ecological system the size of Earth with its vigorous and all-encompassing biosphere can exist in perpetuity. However, Earth will be utterly consumed on the 2,500-year-long journey. It's going to take 2,500 years to get to this new star, Proxima Centauri. Indeed, Earth is devastated by the Earth engines and accompanying natural cataclysms even before the interstellar journey begins. The thing about these stories, I've mentioned that there's a lot of violence, a lot of graphic violence in these short stories, as there is in the Three Body Trilogy, in the trilogy. There's a lot of violence done to the Earth in these short stories. And so The Wandering Earth is a good example here in the next story as well, which is why I want to end with these two stories. A lot of violence done to the Earth, a lot of violence cataloged against the Earth. And so I was really curious about this, and the way that I understand this is that the Earth is sort of the matrix, and the Earth is this place, the Earth is these competing allegiances between narcissism on one hand, anthropomorphism on the one hand, and this desire to achieve a kind of post-human, scientifically oriented post-human objectivity on the other hand, that might help us to reorient ourselves and to achieve some kind of environmental balance. Nevertheless, these things, these competing forces get played out on the surface of the Earth. And so the Earth is this place where this battle takes place in Lou's mind. And the Earth really, really suffers the consequences too. The narrator of The Wandering Earth recounts a long-ago school trip to the greatest of Earth engines, taller than Mount Everest. These Earth engines are these great machines that dig up the Earth and churn it up and use the minerals and so on that it needs for the sake of whatever big science project is happening at the time. The narrator of The Wandering Earth recounts a long-ago school trip to the greatest of the Earth engines, taller than Mount Everest, quote, feeling its tremors shake the very Earth, spread across the plains of China and North America. The Earth engines lay waste to the Earth as they propel the Earth towards its new star. So, a lot of violence done against the Earth in these stories. In The Longest Fall, this is the last story in the collection in The Wandering Earth. It's called The Longest Fall. In this short story, Planetary Devastation, is justified as the prime motive for technological innovation. This final short story in the Wandering Earth collection begins ominously, quote, as the Earth's natural resources dwindled and its environment deteriorated, the world turned its gaze to Antarctica. The background story involves the fierce competition among already environmentally devastated nations to access the mineral riches of the Antarctic. China takes a commanding lead by using experimental solid-state fissile materials to carve out a tunnel straight through the Earth, linking the northernmost city in China's eastern parts of the Antarctic Peninsula. And part of the joy, if you're into this sort of thing, and reading stories like this, is science, is the sort of explication of the science involved, which Lou is really, really good at delivering. The Antarctic Doorstep Project is initially backed by the most influential Communist Party politicians, but it leads to unprecedented disaster and an assessment that implicitly seems to condemn the leadership's long-term obsession with rapid and sustained economic expansion, as well as the philosophy of scientific development as formerly preached by the engineer president Hu Jintao, who was the last president of China, in support of economic growth. The character Mr. Deng explains that the project, quote, was an unprecedented feat of human technology, digging a hole through the Earth, a tunnel through the Earth, and also an act of unparalleled economic folly. The Earth suffered the consequences. Quote, like the rest of the planet, Antarctica was ravaged, leaving nothing but a smog-smothered dump. So that's the result. However, according in the short story, it's all for the best. The time-traveling scientist Hu Bai, it's his name, wakes up from his cryogenic sleep 50 years later to discover a bright new world. So when he goes to sleep, a mess. And 50 years later, everything's okay. During his long sleep, Earth had become utterly toxic. The situation called for the development of newer technologies to fix the problem. The Earth tunnel spawns the Earth Cannon, which shoots people and industrial machinery to the moon and artificial satellites at low cost. Thus, the Earth is bought time to recover and regain ecological balance, presumably so that the process of extreme exploitation can begin anew. Ubai's final vision of the Earth, invoked in the final pages of the book, is not nearly so much utopian as it is to recall words investigated at some length previously here, pathetic, narcissistic, and chauvinistic. And this is a passage from the conclusion of the short story. Ubai was intoxicated by the sights, looking at the azure earth below. Tears began to well up in his eyes. Then and there he fervently wished upon all the stars, still and moving, that every single person who had ever worked the Antarctic doorstep, living and dead, could see all this. What he sees in his thoughts are the faces of his scientists and patriots gazing together upon the wonders they have wrought in spite of their disregard for the Earth. True, they are guilty of environmental devastation for fast profit, but that is only in the short term, for they are finally redeemed by a future that still possesses the power of redemption in blue science fiction, where techno-scientific problem solving comes in play, but so does narcissism. Yet in spite of this promised redemption, Lu's Earth is still adrift, as is Lu's China. The fact is that the promise is irredeemable, since the whole point of such science fiction in the optative mood lies in the deferral. Such deferral or deference to the future is critical because these wandering on stories suggest so much of the grave danger in the present of China's industrialized and urbanized modernization. In other words, there's this is getting back to this tension at work between narcissism and anthropomorphism on one hand, and this posthumanist perspectivism on the other hand, that really sort of is fundamental to lose writing. Here, we've got these short stories. A lot of these short stories seem to give some sort of tacit assent to this ecological devastation that occurs for the sake of industrial development, for the sake of whatever the big science task is at hand. China's modernization is like the West's in its sheer exploitativeness, but in Lu's storytelling it is different too in its scale and in its possibly fatal belatedness. Here then it's useful to note one final difference between the British Clark and the Chinese Lu. If the difference between Clark's major optative and minor depressive moods is more or less distinguishable, it is not so in Lu's fictions. In The Wandering Earth, the Golden Age revision of the bright future is always plagued by destruction and devastation. It's not so much that we will all have to go through hell to get to our new star, our better fate. It's more like hell is our new fate in Lu's stories. The journey is everything. Lu undeniably shares with Clark a faith in the transformative power of technoscience. As for literature, according to Lu, it is dangerously parochial if it is not jolted out of its narrow limits. If literature itself is not repositioned, finding itself a new and strange territory by rubbing alongside science's cosmic and ahuman orientation. Thus, Lu's repositioning helps us to reevaluate and reappreciate the science fiction legacy which he channels so creatively. Now, I hope you were able to make some sense of this, because I had to get rid of a lot of stuff and try to tie some bits together. But thank you for listening.
Question time. We've got some time for questions.
Yeah. How strong is the presence of politics in Chinese science fiction? You alluded to some, you mentioned some criticism, but is, for example, Chinese science fiction occasionally used to criticize some aspects of life in China today or in the bad old system?
I think so, and I think that what I'm trying to do is sort of extricate and pull out and sort of highlight some of that kind of criticism, implicit political criticism, implicit criticism of environmental and ecological policy, but also, of course, a real sort of ambivalent sense of what kind of what can be done. I mean, what I'm suggesting is that Lu recognizes, and he recognizes there's a recognition in these short stories that there's this tremendous, he focuses on devastation, ecological, environmental devastation in so many of these stories. So there is an implicit critique of that ecological devastation that's part of China's development today. It's fascinating.
Now these would be those neoliberal policies that are blamed for this. What about the old system?
The old system, you mean like Mao and so on?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a good question. You know, the first part of the trilogy, this novel called The Three Body Problem, starts in Mao's China. That starts during the Cultural Revolution. So there is a real sense of critique that's part of the very beginning of this trilogy, and then it moves on to other things. You do find it. Now, it's always a question of, you know, I mean, I suppose you could say the same thing about writers in other parts of the world, too. It's very much a question of how you play the game and how you communicate your dissent or your critique. So, you know, there's a novel called The Fat Years, I forget, the Chinese novel, which is very, very critical of Chinese leadership in the 1990s and the student uprising. This is what it's all about. And this novel was banned in China. It's available in the United States, it's available for English speakers, but it's still banned in China. Mm-hmm. So there are some things that you can't do, of course. It's a communist government, and it's a quite repressive government that's in power right now. I'm American, and I'm sure that you can say the same thing about the United States to some degree. Obviously, you know, the publishing industry is going to allow for certain kinds of expression and not allow for other kinds of expression. So I think the answer is yes.
Okay.
So you said you are interested in this connection between the two authors. So I wonder if you are familiar with the Hyperion characters, Radar Simons. Because, he has this great connection with the kids. When he's using his poetry, he's using his persona, his two characters from the book are literally the persona of the kids. He's using them to write the kids' poetry. I think this is really fascinating, like this connection between the two authors.
Yeah, definitely. I haven't read this in years and years. I can't really speak with any authority about it. You can probably speak a lot about it with a lot more authority than I can. I don't remember it so well, but it's a great science fiction achievement. But you're right, the relationship between Dan Simmons and Keats really, really important. And that would be a really fascinating thing to investigate too.
Yeah, also this thing about the Earth, because I don't know if you remember, but the old Earth is some kind of lost, but then somehow find it out again. Uh-huh. They make this forecast to the Earth, but it is a bad one. It's just a problem for the humanity.
Yeah.
So, connection.
Yeah, great book, or a series of books.
Another question? But no? I thought you
could. If you're not a science fiction fan, it's probably going to be a lot harder to kind of get in here and say much.
I might have a question. Not so much a quick question, as a comment maybe, or some request for your comments, Stephen. Without having read, I know those stories, I might admit, by the Chinese writer, I feel that he's playing, among other things, many other things, he's playing with the notion of the Earth as home, or the Earth as an ecological system, but in all kinds of ways you can understand that the Earth as a system in itself, a kind of self-sufficient and self-standing. That's Earth as a planet that sits there in space and is the home for humans. Hence the idea of transporting it to some other solar system, which is nonsensical, basically, because you can't do it. I mean, it's integrated within the whole system of the solar system, the whole universe. You just cannot take one element and move it to other planes. It's not a spare part. So, you can't do it. It's not only technological, but the very idea of it. I mean, I don't think it's... This is definitely playing with people's imagination and and kind of an imaginary world that is bound to fade. But then, so that's one understanding. But then another one is the ecological system of the universe, where the universe is the home for humans. And the Earth is, well, it is a home, but it's more of a vehicle, more of a temporary, not necessarily temporary, but a local kind of a kind of a location where people happen to be, but yet they live in this very broad, wide space, that all of it being humanity's home. And that, I think, is one of the things that Clark and Kubrick probably were saying, at least the way I read Space Odyssey. When you have these people traveling through space, it's a dangerous place, because it's been unexplored, and yet this is the home. They've been triggered by the computer, but the universe itself is not an empty space. There's someone there, as you said, and that someone is for humans to get in touch with. So there's a very broad, understanding of what ecosystem the humans are living in, what kind of home we are basically inhabiting.
It's a question about the ecosystem of the universe, though.
Yes.
The question has to do with this, and I think I think you're right. I mean, this is an interesting observation. And it's quite different, and this is something that's kind of remarkable. Quite different, the nature of the ecosystem, the universal ecosystem, quite different. It's a great difference between Clark and Bloom. Because for Clark was a pretty, he had some depressive moods that he would display in his fiction, but by and large, a very optimistic writer. You know, a technological optimist, Clark, for the most part. Not so with Blue exactly, although yes in part and no in another part. But for Clark anyway, the universe, as you're pointing this out, Adam, is a pretty safe space. The danger in 2001 is technology. It's the conflict between man and technology. It's how, it's the computer system that wants to kill everybody on the spaceship. And it succeeds, except for the one guy, Bowman, who manages to get through this wormhole and go on this weird, crazy trip, and this is the conclusion of the movie, which is an amazing visual experience. But the universe is a place where man is destined to go. For Clark, he's destined. Humankind is destined to move forward, to leave Earth behind, and to inhabit the stars. For Lou, this is true too. For Lou, it is deadly. Deadly dangerous, the universe. And, there's a certain kind of thinking these days. And I think about this a lot. When I was a kid, and these radio telescopes were going up, and people like Carl Sagan were very, very interested in communicating to the aliens out there that we're here, and we want to know you, and we want to be friends with you. Now, for a writer like Lou, for a guy like Stephen Hawking, and for many other people, that's the wrong plan. We shouldn't be telling the universe that we're here, because this is only courting trouble. So this has to do with a very, very different kind of outlook, a very different perspective on our relationship to the universe. For Clark, we're situated in this universe, this vast universe, which can accept us. And we can do this, but for Lou, it's tremendously dangerous. A tremendously dangerous thing. Certainly, broadcasting our location to aliens, you don't do that. But of course, Lou is a hard science fiction writer, and he does believe in the inevitability of humankind going out into the planets and beyond too.
Any more? Thank you very much, then.
Great.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.